What is the geometry of space? Space is certainly not flat, like Einstein found, but is it sufficient to describe the forces of nature in a unified way? In this video, I will present to you Burkhard Heim's solutions, which we will see is much more general and yet corresponds to Einstein's findings. Hello and welcome to Six Dimensions in Color. My name is Hannes Schmid, and I explain to you Burkhard Heim's worldview in understandable language and with clear examples. One of the first questions when approaching Heim theory is, how did he find that we live in a six-dimensional world? In this video, I will take even one step further back and talk about his approach to the basic geometry of space-time. At this time, my English channel about Heim theory is still very, very young. So, if you want to help spread Heim's thoughts and my work, like, share, and subscribe. I've decided to go more into the background of his original thoughts in this video series, so for all those who know my German channel, you may still find something new in here. I will require you to watch some math in this video, or rather this video series, which you may or may not be familiar with from Einstein's theory of general relativity. If you are not, then just let it pass over you and concentrate on the overall concepts and arguments and on the background pictures. Heim's deduction about the dimensionality of the world begins with the question about the geometry of space itself. At this point, it is merely a question of how to unify the forces of nature in a four-dimensional universe. And Heim found to do that, we must generalize the Riemann metric tensor of Einstein's general relativity theory even further so that we obtain a non-hermitian metric tensor, which leads to a more general Cartan geometry. Let's have a look at space-time metrics in complex number notation. Star means complex conjugate, as usual. The plus and minus indices mean two different kinds of metrics. Heim argued these should be assumed because there are obviously two kinds of forces at work in the universe, gauge-invariant ones and non-gauge-invariant ones. I believe that's only one way, that's only one argument why those should be assumed. I think there may be others. Let us write the metric equation in the long form. And then we get three parts of coordinate differentials, which can be interpreted as metric tensors or as parts of a metric tensor. If you play with the indices, you can show that G1 is Hermitian, as well as G3 is. The more tricky part is the middle one, because if you multiply it out, you obtain something that is Hermitian as well. But that's not necessarily true for this partial tensor G2. Because if it were non-Hermitian, the anti-Hermitian components would cancel each other out. And therefore, G2 must be assumed non-Hermitian, and so must the metric tensor, which Heim called the fundamental tensor. If that is so, we can split this tensor in a Hermitian and anti-Hermitian part, as we can do with any complex tensor or matrix. The plus and minus indices now, of course, mean Hermitian and anti-Hermitian. If we now further assume, as Einstein did, that physical fields can be expressed through geometry, then we can assume the existence of a general energy tensor, which is in turn non-Hermitian, and can be split in the same manner. And likewise, we can split the Ricci tensor and the Christoffel symbols. As the Christoffel symbols are derivatives of the metric tensor, and we are now basing everything on this generalized non-Hermitian tensor, we can regard it as a generalized potential for interaction forces, and thus for interaction of physical fields. If in this concept we neglect the parts 2 and 3 of our metric tensor, like this, then we obtain the familiar Hermitian tensor of general relativity. And if we assume that the unified energy tensor only contains electromagnetism and not gravity, then we have the same tensor as Einstein assumed. So we see that general relativity is an approximation of Heim's more general non-Hermitian approach. General relativity's concept is that mass causes gravity, And thus, it is a causal relation between mass and geometry. However, Heim requires a general energy tensor, which not only includes the source of the field, but the field itself. At the same time, we have a fundamental tensor, which stands for generalized interaction potentials. And therefore, we can no longer assume that there is a causal relation between mass or mass and energy and geometry, but it is an equivalence principle. As for now, this doesn't help us yet to integrate the quantum principle into this geometric approach. But we're going to come there. Let us now see what follows from this equivalence principle. Let us say our general energy tensor may be W. Then it must be proportional to the change of action in a differential volume. But from experience, we know that all action is quantized by Planck's quantum of action. So a given action omega must equal Planck's quantum of action times a natural number. If we stick to that rule, then we must find that our differential transforms to differences in that way. So eta can be interpreted as the number of action quanta in a given quantized volume. If we now remember our equivalence principle of energy and geometry, then we must conclude that if energy is quantized, so must be geometry. And how this geometry will look like, we will see in the coming videos in six dimensions and in color.